that, you know, he got up there, and he, every time I'd ride up on my bicycle, and I'd been to prison 5 times, man. I was a drug addict. I was an alcoholic. I was a misfit. I was everything in a bag of chips. And he said, you know, but Pastor James, every time I'd come up on that bicycle, he'd say, there comes a mighty man of God. Boy, look at that anointing on that man. Woo! Praise God. And, you know, he'd go home. He said, I'd go, where'd he see that at, man? I'm about to kill myself. I hate life and hate everything. I'm just a mess. But you know, he said, he got me filled with the Holy Ghost. And my life changed forever. Now that man owns his own business, has 2 homes, got a productive business, sings in his church, gives his testimony everywhere, living for God. And you know, it's because fear was destroyed and faith was elevated. There's a thing that we can look at many testimonies of people that got wonderful testimonies, and some they do. But then we got to look at everybody and say, where are we at as individuals? Where are we at? Each person has to stand up and look at themselves every day. They either look at who they see in the mirror, or they look in the Word of God and see who they are in Him. God never lies. The mirror does. The mirror has a reflection of things that we have done. But God told Adam the day he ate of that tree, he said, the day you eat of it, you'll die. And the minute he ate of that tree, he died. But what was the first thing that came out of death? Fear. Where you at, Adam? I'm hiding. Why are you hiding? Because I was naked and I'm afraid. Everyone say, I'm afraid.
I'm afraid.
See, fear is a force that came from hell. It didn't come from heaven. Fear is something we should never, ever have to deal with because Christ dealt with it for us. When he conquered death, hell, and the grave, when he took on every sin that we've ever done in our life and he conquered it, then it has no dominion over us anymore. So fear was dealt with at the cross. Fear gave us resurrection power to overcome anything that tries to make us afraid. See, the word fear means subjected to bondage. When you get into fear, you're heading into bondage. Because really, you're saying the devil is more powerful than God. I know God's good, and I know God cares, and I know God, but. We know about buts. They stink. And they will stink up your thought process. They will stink up your life if you start thinking God is not an equal opportunity God. If we could have got clean from the fear of death and dying, Jesus wouldn't have had to die in vain. He'd have died in vain. If he did not die for us, then we could not have the grace that God gives us to live our life without fear. Fear is going to be something that's going to try to control you and bind you. See, the law of life has authority over the law of sin and death in Romans 8:2. It says, for the law of the Spirit of life. Everybody say that.
For the law of the Spirit of life.
In Christ Jesus.
Christ.
Hath made me free.
Made me free.
From the law of sin and death.
From the law of sin and death.
Did it say made you free from the law of sin and death?
Yes.
Where does sin and death live at? In our members. In our body. For the law of the Spirit of life. There's a new law. The law of liberty and freedom. And God said, you are free. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. There is no reason to be afraid. Sin can take an occasion of the flesh, but it cannot take you out of the hand of God. Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. So what he's saying is, look guys, we should live in the Spirit. When you were born again, you were born from above. That meant you now are love's object of affection in this life. God looks at you with such a sincere love. He says, man, you are the ones that were bought with my Son's blood. What could make me love you anymore? If my son bled out and died for you, you must be very special to him. So therefore, you're very, very special to me. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Can I get a better amen?
Amen.
You see, you have to adopt the truth in your life so you can establish a principle of faith against the principles of fear. Fear not, for I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. Romans 6:11. Likewise, reckon you yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, what does it say? Reckon? Everybody say reckon. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead and dead to sin. What does it mean to reckon? Huh? Think the same way. That's good. I'll try to answer that. If I reckon myself, what does that mean? I see that I got a bunch of goos in me. I got a bunch of junk. But God said, I'm not to, that he crucified, was crucified and delivered me from that sin. Is that a thought? Huh? So he said, I have delivered you by my death from the power of death. Now then, you and I have to reckon. Reckon means according to what he said, not according to what I do. The reason people so adamantly follow sin and fall short is because they are still in that crossroad of saying, I believe he saved me so I can go to heaven, but I don't believe he saved me from me that I can be free from sin. And until you reckon, everybody say reckon. Till I reckon myself dead. I reckon. That means I count it according to what he said. Not because of what I feel. Not because I think that way. I reckon. Jesus, you said that. I accept it. And I feel like an idiot doing that. Because I just know me too well. And God says, that's right. That's why you still act like hell. Because you know you too well. But you don't know the one he said. That I delivered you from that old you and I made you a new you. Woo-hoo! A new you. You see, life casts out death. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Now, did it say reign? Did that say that? Okay, listen, he didn't say he took sin out of you. Sin still lives in your mortal body, but it doesn't have to rule and reign in your body. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it and the lusts thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Everybody say, I'm under grace.
I'm under grace.
Not under law.
Not under law.
Now look, law is going to show you what's wrong with you. Anyone in here today had the law judge them this week and they saw, I could see some sin in me. That's its job. But grace's job is to say, I have set you free. You need to understand that. You need to reckon when fear comes knocking at your door, you are not to give a place. I'm sorry, I'm not home. Whom shall I fear if the Lord be for me? Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith, and he is the destroyer of our fear. See, to act on fear is to act as if Satan is bigger than God. How many of y'all think Satan's bigger than God? But you know what? When you get into fear, you've made Jesus bow to Satan. Oh, but James, you don't know how I feel. I'd be scared. I'd be scared. I know I messed up. I did an uh-oh, and I really feel horrible about it. How do I fix it? Everybody say repent.
Repent.
That's all you got to do. There was a lady the other day come and said, the 1 John 1:9 shouldn't even be in the Bible anymore. 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. See, there's a lot of Christians that do not want to understand that that sin nature is still inside you. It will not be gone until you and I go home and get our glorified body. Anyway, only Jeff Coco in this room is the only one I know that don't have sin in his life. Everybody else has just got a mess. Sorry, Cindy. But when you sit down and you recognize this, listen to me, guys. If you try to live perfect, you're going to fail. I need Jesus every single day. I need him every minute. And I know that in me that is in my flesh dwells no good thing, for the will is present. Listen, it's easy to make a mistake, and the devil will go, see there you did. Law said that, law said this, law said that. Yeah, I know, but grace said this. You know what, devil? My life is forever and eternally secure inside Jesus Christ. And I know that I've got a carnal nature that's sold unto sin that lives inside me. But I got a new nature in my spirit man. Say my spirit man. My inner man, that inner man, all of a sudden one day this earth suit's going to crack open and my inner man is going to be released and I'm going to go back to Jesus and he's going to say, come here, son. I'm so glad you held on to the very end. Not that you didn't sin. In fact, he said in 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Then he said, if you say you have no sin, you make God a liar and the truth isn't in you. See, God's trying to get you and I delivered from sin consciousness by satisfying the issue that we were all sold unto sin by what Adam did. But we've all been sold unto righteousness by what Jesus did. Now, it's not me being perfect. It's me recognizing the perfect one. Jesus is the personification of perfection. He is my righteous right arm. He is my upholder. He's the lifter of my head. He's the one who cares about me. Can I get an amen? Luke 5:8. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John and the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, fear not. Everybody say, fear not.
Fear not.
From henceforth thou shalt catch men. Look, what I see is this argumentative fisherman that's wanting to sit here and, look, Jesus, if you know the story, he fished all night. And he was plumb tuckered out. And Jesus got in the boat today. Launch out and drop down our nets, man. Let's get some fish. Now, JC, listen. Just don't cross the line right now. I know you're a great preacher, man. And you've got all the goods from the kingdom. But I'd be a fisherman. How many think you know a little bit about what you know? And how many times your pride level gets you and say, no, wait a minute. I know. And God says, no, you know nothing. If I tell you something, you better take it to the bank. Drop that net down. And he almost sunk the boat. They had so many fish. And Peter was totally slam dunked. His pride was just like a pop in a balloon. And he was down and he said, my Lord and my God. The winds obey you. The storms cease. You have disproved me every time I've tried to set up and do something for you. And he said, Peter, I cannot use you as long as you think you can do something for me. I'm trying to get it through your head. Listen to me. What I tell you, that's what you can do. What I tell you. If we would follow Jesus Christ, we would be blessed and happy and fulfilled in everything we do because we choose to follow faith and not fear. But if you give fear a place, it's going to come running. And that's what we see here. Fear caused Peter to tell Jesus to depart from him. Do you realize that all Jesus wanted to do was bless Peter? And his pride level humbled down and said, just get away from me. I'm ashamed. How many of us have looked at our lives and said, God, how could you use me? I'm so ashamed of myself. I ain't never done nothing right. It seems like everything I do is wrong. And Jesus said, repent. I'm not trying to correct you. I'm trying to make an adjustment in you that you will see that all the blessings and favor that I have put inside you, I want you to be able to recognize it over what fear tries to make you recognize. He said, I want you to look at me. I want you to see through my eyes. Hebrews 2:14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Did you see that he said that the children of Israel were by nature lived in fear of death and dying? They never knew if God really, really would save them or take care of them because they knew they had sin in their lives. They tried to live the best they could, and they were afraid of death because they didn't know if God was pleased enough with them. And Jesus said that I put on the earth suit to show you that God's love raised me from the dead when I took your sins upon myself and I died on that tree. Now then, you've been set free. All you should have is victory. If you tell fear to shut up and let faith come out of your mouth. Start saying to that mountain, be cast into sea. Refuse to say what your flesh says. Put your mouth sounding like you're crazy. I'm blessed. I'm highly favored. I'm something that, oh, I'm God's favorite. And boy, you'll look in the mirror and go, what in the heck am I saying? Good gosh. That's wishful thinking. No, it's not. It's knowledgeable thinking. It's starting to think like God and what he says about you and me. See, the fear of death put the children of Israel in subjection to bondage. The ministry of torment is to drive you to act on fear. It says, you'll never make it. Your loved one in the hospital, they're never going to make it. This is never going to happen. You wait and you watched all your life, you and fall of God stuff. How many kids are still in the hospital? How many people are going through things? How come? Why ain't it perfect yet? It's very simple, devil. You idiot. I'll not listen to you. I'll listen to my God. My father said, my sister's healed. That little boy's healed. Every person we pray for is healed. You want to give and say, well, I hope so. Well, I hope so. Then that means I don't know so. Where do we start seeing that Jesus rose from the dead? He conquered death, hell, and the grave, sickness and disease, pestilence, violence, poverty, and shame. He caused the devil to be ridiculed. We must believe that. See, we need to speak against torment. Say, I speak against torment.
I speak against torment.
Say, I act against torment.
I act against torment.
See, we drive Satan away. The Holy Spirit will act on your action. When you stand up and say, I will give no place to you. You get out of my face. You get out of my house. You get out of my body. You get out of my life. I do not surrender to you, fear. My Bible said, fear not. Then I'm going to say, fear not. See, the devil wants to oppress you. Oppression is the spoiling or taking away of men's goods or estates by terror or force without having any right thereto by working on the ignorance, weakness, or fearfulness of the oppressed. Acts 10:38. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Say, God was with him.
God was with him.
Then God said, if you're oppressed, so pressed, depressed, then you need to repent and rebuke the devil and say, get out of my house, get out of my body, get out of my mind. I am not going to be ruled by fear. I'm going to be ruled by faith. The life I now live from this night forward, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You see, we must arise and shine, for the reason that God saved you and me is to set someone free. Listen, is Jesus the same yesterday, today, and forever?
Yes. Yes.
Then he lives inside you and me.
Yes.
Then we should be the same. We should not look at ourselves through our mortal conditioning, but look through our supernatural conditioning. Christ in you is the hope of glory. And as you yield to that glorious one on the inside of you, the world cannot receive Jesus because they don't see him in us. They mock it. They make fun of it because they see all the garbage. One says, unless you're rich and famous, you don't know God. One says, unless you're in abstract poverty, you don't know God. If one says you don't have a fight with sickness and disease, you don't know God. One says that you get sickness and disease, you don't know God. Would the real truth get up on the front platform? We look unto the author and finisher of our faith. Looking unto Jesus. Jesus said, I chose you. I elected you. You are holy and righteous and upright. Now I want you to stand. And when you've done all to stand?
Stand.
And when you've done all to stand?
Stand.
You see, if you don't stand, then we all fall. There's the weakest link is when someone says, I don't know. Then you're divisive. You're going and get tossed to and fro. And pretty soon you don't know what's going on in life. We have given our lives to Jesus because he gave us his life. And as we start walking in faith, then we start delivering other people. Ephesians 3:9. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose. Everybody say eternal purpose. Which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. We have boldness and access and confidence in him. See, if you don't feel confident, it's because you're forgetting who you are. You were set apart and chose by God himself. We were predestined before the foundation of the world. Listen, folks, right now, 100 years from now, we're still going to be his children, whether we're in this body or not. That's never going to change. The grace gift of God was, he said, you asked me because I asked you first. You didn't choose me. I chose you. Now, therefore, if he chose you, does he not believe in you more than you believe in yourself? Huh? Sometimes he's saying, challenge the fear that's living inside you. A lot of times you have problems and circumstances that come up awry in your life because God's trying to say, would you wake up? Deal with that fear. Have faith in God. Who will ever say that mountain be thou removed and cast in the sea and shall not doubt in his heart, but believe in his mouth what he saith, he shall have it. Then open that mouth and say, I'm a blessed man. I'm a blessed woman. I thank you, God. I'm not moved by what my bank account said. I'm not moved by what things were. Father God, I call that money into me in Jesus' name. And lo and behold, it starts coming. You go, huh? How'd that happen? Say, my mouth. Your mouth has to either give place to fear or it gives place to faith. It's your choice. You must make a decision while the time is still day when we can all say the right thing. Boldness and power come as we act, not before we act. Matthew 18:18. Verily, verily, I say unto James Benson, Whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And again I say that if any two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that it shall have, they shall have it done to them by the Father which is in heaven. Cindy asked me once a month to always go over and pray over her business. Because why? Ever since we've done that, she's had a landfall prophet come through. People, one lady that come to work for her said, my God, she said, I have never worked in a place that I have sold everything I got so quick. I can't understand. That place has got so much love flowing in. It's got Jesus all over. You feel his presence and it just draws people in. Why? Any shall come to Anna. And what? If any two should come together and agree as touching anything. Well, Brother James, I don't know if I don't do it. Well, then sit over in corner X while they go to corner Y and they get real high because they see the sky's the limit. There's no thing that's impossible to them that believe. The only thing we've got to get reckoned with is that fear does not have any place in our life. And when it tries to come, we need to deal with it immediately. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
In Revelations 1:17, and when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, fear not. Everybody say that. I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, gaze upon this, look intently at this. I am alive forevermore and have the keys of hell and of death. Jesus has the keys of hell and death. And you and I, those doors have been locked and we don't have a key to them. Hell and death has been binded away from you and me. You may die in your natural, but you'll never die in your spirit. You'll never die. The Bible said to be absent from the body is to be ever present with the Lord. All of a sudden, we're going to leave out of this earth suit and take our last breath here, and we're going to inhale in there and go, wow. Wow, God. This is awesome. Psalms 118:6. The Lord is on my side. Everybody say that.
The Lord is on my side.
Now say it like you mean it.
The Lord is on my side.
See how loud your voice, when you start letting your mouth get inside your mouth and it starts releasing from your heart, there's an empowerment in that. Your words are powerful. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. You need to write that down. Every day you get up and read that. The Lord is on my side and I will not fear. What can man do unto me? Woo-hoo-hoo. Who shall I fear if the Lord before me? Isaiah 54:14. In righteousness shalt thou be established. Thou shalt be far from oppression. For thou shalt not fear. For thou shalt
not fear.
And from terror, for it shall not come near thee. You see, righteousness was something we inherited by faith. When we believed on Jesus Christ by faith, when he said, for by grace are you saved through faith and not of yourselves, it was a gift of God. This position that God gave you with himself was not meritable or deserved. It was given as a gift to those who believed on what Jesus did. I have the legal right to be a son of God in right standings with God, not based on what my flesh does or says, but based upon what God's love says. His mercy and grace shall abide with me forever, he said. He said, if my word abides in you, takes up residence in you, then you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Free from what? Fear. Fear not. When fear comes, it has a right to come. It just don't have a right to stay. I can look at fear and go, oh, what are you all about? What are you coming up for? Okay, well, let's just see what the word says about you today. Behold, it said, they shall surely gather together, but not by me. Whosoever shall gather together against thee shall fall for thy sakes. Behold, I have created the smith that bloweth the coals in the fire, and that bringeth forth an instrument for his work. And I have created the waste to destroy it, the waters to destroy. No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that rises up against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Everybody say, I am righteous.
I am righteous.
That is a heritage of the Lord. But Brother James, you just don't understand. I live in this mess, and I've just gone through this, and I'm going through that, and I still do this, and I still do that. I said, well, why don't you get out of the washing machine? You know, how long will you stand between two positions? God said, you're righteous and holy and upright. But you want to tell God, yeah, one day I'll be there. And God said, no, you won't. You either are right now or you never will be. Righteousness was a gift by faith. It's not something you earn or deserve. When you clean your life up, when you get to smelling good and looking good and all that other stuff, you'll still be rotten to the core. Because you think in yourself, you can do something to make God be pleased with you. And God says, How can I be any more pleased than you that I sent my son to die for you? I rescued you from you and the devil. Now all you got to do is humble yourself and say, I accept that, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. I can't ever fix me. He said, quit trying. Why don't you just kill that guy? Why don't you just die to him? Why don't you reckon yourself alive to me? Just reckon it. If you can't believe it, just reckon it. Just count it as that way. And all of a sudden, it'll start growing in your life. It'll start changing in your life. Hebrews 13, verse 6. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What shall man do unto me? The Lord is my helper. I've heard preachers on TV say, these people trying to make God their slave. They just think they can snap their finger and get. Did he just say the Lord is my helper? Huh? If the Lord be for us, who can be against us? That means he's our ever-present help in the time of our trouble, in the time of fear, in the time of things that are coming against you that say, what about this? I can say, no, no, no. What about this? You're not going to change my mind by circumstances. The just live by faith. And therefore, we decree a thing and God establishes it. See, Satan cannot do anything to us apart from fear. Any more than God could do something for us apart from faith. Do you hear me? God cannot do anything that faith will not provide for you. It'd be just a carnal thing that you've got a logic system and you're trying to work out a do good, get good. And God says, that's corrupt. Faith moves God because faith is in God. Fear moves Satan because fear is in Satan. When I hear fear, I hear Satan. When I hear faith, I hear Jesus. Jesus will always move you to perform. Because remember, by grace are we saved through faith and not of ourselves. It was a gift of God. So then grace is salvation. But we receive salvation by faith. It's by grace that we save through faith. That means grace is my provision. Faith is my provider. God gave us a measure of faith to receive the gift of grace that he has for our stinking carcass. Thank you, Jesus, for grace. Woo-hoo! Thank you, God. If it was up to me, I'd still send me to hell. But God, you're so awesome. I'm just going to let you be the glory and the lifter of my head. I'm going to let you be the author and the finisher of my faith. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Irrelevant of circumstances. Because God can't lie. Can I get amen?
Amen.
See, Hebrews 11:1 says, what is faith? Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not yet seen. Now, I want you to see something. When is faith?
Now.
Now. It's the substance of things hoped for. That word substance in the Greek means the assurance of and the reality of. So faith is the assurance of and the reality of the things you hope for. Do you know the devil's not after your faith? He's after your hope. If you can't hope that tomorrow's going to be better than today, it won't be. If you can't hope that your love, I was preaching to this church, and this one pastor and I were talking. I met a lady that I'd known from the old church I used to be in, and she's in her 80s, and sweetheart, her husband died about, ten years ago, and I did his funeral. And she remembered me. She had a soft spot in her heart for me. We talked. But her pastor was telling me, after we got through preaching, we was eating, and he was telling me about her, that her husband, he was an ex-Marine. He had all kinds of, he was really a tough banana. And it was hard. They went through a lot of hardship through their whole marriage. But she stood by him. She just, you know, God, this is my husband. I'm going to make it with him. This is the way it is. And, you know, he used to go to the hospital and visit him when he was getting sick. And he said, you know, he would tell him, I don't know why God won't ever save me. He said, I've been too bad. I've been too messed up and all that. He goes, well, you know what, son? That's not what he tells me. He tells me he loves you. You're very special to him. So you just get to thinking about that. You talk to him. So he said, when he came back another time to see him in the hospital, he passed him a note. And he was dying. He stuck it in his pocket. He didn't look at it. That evening, the man died. I did his funeral. In fact, I didn't even remember that he and his singing group sang at his funeral that I did. He goes, that's where I saw you at. That's where I remember you from. And the man that was in the singing group was his associate pastor, that I knew him too. It was a small world, how things tie together. But then he said, she was tearful, and she was saying, you know, I just don't know if he went to heaven or not. I just don't know. He just didn't, the Holy Ghost reminded him that paper was in his pocket. He says, oh, here. He gave me this before he died. I don't know what it is. Let's open and look at it. And he said, I know Jesus, and Jesus knows me.
Amen.
Thank you, preacher. She was just boo-hoo. You see, we don't know a human being's heart. God does. This thing was not about, let me see how virtuous you are versus how not virtuous I am. This is about grace and favor to the God who loves his people, and he's not looking at how much you sin, he's looking at how much he loves you.
Amen.
How much he wants to set you free. And that set her free. There were so many things that when we go through life that we can remember. I remember my little grand, I told her this story, got her crying out in the parking lot, we were crying together. But my little Aunt Feely, how when I was a kid, and how Aunt Feely, when I loved her, my daddy was an adopted, she loved my daddy. Every time she'd see him come, we'd go visit him in San Antonio. Boy, Aunt Feely would get out this stuff, so whipping up a peach cobbler or an apple cobbler or whatever, because, man, she knew my daddy liked cobblers. She just loved my daddy. And, you know, when I got out of prison, my mama said, let's go up there, let's go see Aunt Feely. And I went up there, and when I saw Aunt Feely, she was in her 80s, and I just started crying. I said, Aunt Feely, I'm worthless. I'm no good. And she's, oh, darling, you're so beautiful. Jesus loves you so much. You're so special to him. You know, she gave me hope that I could be forgiven, that I could go forward. You see, sometimes just picking somebody apart and tearing them down won't not bring them to Christ. But loving on them, saying, look, we've all had that bad seed sown in us. But God's trying to pluck it out. Just give it to him. There's plenty of time. He ain't through with you yet. You wouldn't be spilling out trying to make me hate you. if you weren't so afraid of what I have, because you think you can't have it. If we learn to love like Jesus unconditionally, we'll see it change. We'll see people's lives come. But see, fear says, well, you better not get around them. You better not do that. This will do this and this will do that. No, fear not. I ain't worried about what the devil's going to do. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for. If you hope someone's going to be saved, then you start believing for their salvation. And I told her about my father-in-law, how, you know, he was an animal. And boy, he used to tell me, don't you bring that in my house. I don't want nothing to do with it. And I told Charlie, give me 2 minutes, let me tell you. I told him a plan of salvation. He said, don't ever mention it again. 12 years went by. But I prayed, I said, God, you said that you, to pray the Lord of the harvest, that you'd send laborers across their path. Peter, James, and John. I want Peter, James, and John, and I want to be the James. And I said, Lord, you said I could have the heathen for my inheritance. Then I claim them for the kingdom of God. You said that you were long-suffering, that none in my family should perish, that salvation belonged to every one of us. He's the only one left that needs it. So I thank you, Lord God. 12 years went by. That man went blind mowing the yard. Went to the hospital. I was supposed to go to the Kennecote and Biker Conviction next morning, leave. And at Bible school that night, my wife called me, and I went, oh, glory to God, this is that moment I've been waiting for. Praise God. Let's all get together and pray right now. I'm going to that hospital. Went over there. Said, hey, how you doing, brother? Who is it? His eyes wide open. Ooh, couldn't see. I said, James, man. Oh, man, what's going on? I said, well, we're fixing to go to that biker convention. I heard you had, oh, I wish I could go. He had a motorcycle. I said, okay. What are you doing with Jesus? He didn't say get out of the room. He said, I'm talking to him. Well, he loves you. You know what I was. He changed me. He wants you. With snot running out of his nose and crying his eyes out, he prayed and asked Jesus to come in his heart and save him. And that special, precious wind of God gave him that big inhaling from heaven. And all of a sudden, man, I said, you know, God not only saves you, I said, but he wants to heal you. And I stuck my thumbs in his blind eyes and cursed that blindness in the name of Jesus. I said, remember, the Bible said the 10 lepers came and they were healed as they went. Miracles are instantaneous, but signs and wonders are a process when you lay hands and do your part. She said, my wife called me the next day and said, James, you're not going to believe this, but Grandma said that Charlie could see out in the hallway by the next morning. And he said, she said, what did he do to him, Charlie? He's so sweet, man. He's so different. Said he gave him Jesus, Grandma. Amen. See, there's a difference when Jesus walks in. It's the real deal. It's the whole enchilada. And it doesn't matter if you look like you've got it all for the rest of your life or not. God does not change his election. He's the one that's selected. Amen? Amen. See, faith is a spiritual force. It's God's creative power. That's why when you called those things that be not as though they were, you're saying that the things that are temporary are seen, but the things that are not seen are eternal. And you start calling by faith the eternal to come in and replace the temporary. See, it's the substance of things hoped for. Increase the level of hope. Hope for blessings in your life. Hope for your children to be saved. Hope for your family to change. Hope for the circumstance to change. Hope, hope, hope. Now faith has something to work for. It says, that I see what they want. Let's go get it. And starts bringing it together. Okay, what is fear? Mark 4:37. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him, and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said unto another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? 2 Timothy 1:7, he said, for I have not given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Everybody say that. I have not been given the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. God didn't give you fear. Fear came. Fear can get the hell out. Amen. Do not be afraid. You have to learn that the greater one lives inside you and that the other one has a right to come. Always understand that. Satan's force is a destructive power, the substance of things not desired. Fear was the substance of Peter's undesirable failure. When that boat was half full of water, he was freaking out. Master, do you not care? How will we tell God, do you not care? Do you know what I'm suffering with? Do you know what I'm faced with? He goes, no, because you don't know what I'm faced with listening to you. I'm listening to you and it's terrible. You're sitting there like somebody that don't know me. I'd be scared. Look at the circumstance. God said, why do you look at the circumstance? Why don't you look into me? Do you realize I'm trying to establish you for me and my Father in His will in this earth? Look, don't be chicken little about people that need to be saved. Don't be intimidated to go up and say, hey, listen, Jesus loves you. You're very important to Him. Do you have that assurance in your heart if you died, you'd go to heaven? Well, He told me to come tell you that. He told me to tell everybody I know. He wants everybody in heaven. He doesn't want anybody to fail. He's long-suffering that none should perish, but all should have eternal life. How does faith work? It comes by hearing the Word of God. Faith is developed through meditating and acting on God's Word. Look, I had to get the Word positioned in my life that I could hear it. And guess what? It does talk. Faith speaks. I'd walk by rooms and I'd hear, what? Go back in there and pray for that lady. I don't know her. I do. Go pray for her. Many a time I have stopped and went back and talked to someone because the Holy Ghost said, go talk to them. Do you realize there's an eternal world, eternally lost and eternally saved? And God wants everyone to be transferred from one kingdom to another. It's not so much if they come to His church or not. Did they come to the kingdom? Did they receive Jesus Christ on that curve right there? God writes it in the Lamb's Book of Life. There'll be people, when you get to heaven, you go, oh, praise God, give me a hug. I'm so grateful I met you. Woo, I'd have never been here if I wouldn't have got you to coerce me in that parking lot to accept Jesus. That's not a religious thing we do. It's a righteous thing we do. Righteous people lead others to righteousness. When you meditate on the Word, it gives you capacity. It gives you the capacity. Faith is applied by speaking of things that are not as though they were. Romans 4, 16 and 17. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but that also which is of faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. And therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Folks, there is a faith realm that you and I live and walk in. And God wants you to be able to recognize the realm you walk in so you can speak to that and change it. There's a lot of times if you would, there's times God always tell me, are you going to pray for me right now about that? Are you going to bring that to me right now? You mean, Lord, Jesus, because, man, it's a big problem. It's all these things going on. He says, so the problem's bigger than me. No, no. Well, then why won't you pray that with me? Why won't you speak to that thing and command it in Jesus' name to change? All of a sudden it changes. All of a sudden it starts implying to you, stop being quiet. Speak more. Faith speaks. Guess what? Fear also speaks. Fear stands up and it jacks you up from one side down the other. See, Jesus is the author and developer of our faith. But fear works or comes by hearing the word of the world. That's why he said, come out from amongst the world. Be a separate and holy people. The world will lie to you. The world will show you circumstantial evidence of why it is telling the truth when it's nothing but a bald-faced lie. Fear is now, just like faith is now. Fear is developed through meditating and acting on Satan's lies. Well, that's a good thing you're thinking there, honey, but what about this and what about that? He tries to improvise doubt and unbelief, confusion. He tries to get you to thinking, well, if that was true, then how come this and how come that? No, excuse me, devil. It is true. Whether you show me the opposite or not, God can't lie. So I'll stand on what God said no matter what this world says. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
See, fear is developed through meditating and acting on Satan's lies. Fear is applied by speaking of things that are not as though they were. Fear demands compromise. Well, who do you think you are, a son of God? It's very easy. Well, you sure don't look like him. You don't act like him. Well, I'm getting all those things together, though. Satan supports and develops fear. Once you start compromising your faith, then fear starts moving in. It starts trying to grab a hold of you and grip you. Fear becomes doubt and unbelief when it's acted upon. How many people have fallen away from God, will not serve God because they let fear grip them and shut faith out? Fear is not natural to the born-again believer. 1 John 4:15. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him and he in God. And we known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we. Everybody say that. As he is, so are we. Say it again. As he is, so are we. Where? In this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. You need to underline that in your Bible. You need to always remember what God said. Perfect love, that's Jesus, casts out fear because fear is torment. If you're being tormented, if you're being tortured, it's the enemy. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. God loved us before we could love him. Don't turn it around. Don't let the devil get you on a treadmill thinking, you better show God you love him. You better do, 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 do. And if we get this room full of do, do, it's going to stink. Hello? Do not practice loving, just love. And in the process, you'll see your deficiencies. But then you'll turn it over to God and say, you know, God, thank you that you don't count my deficiencies because you are my sufficiency. You are my sufficiency, God. I don't fear sickness and disease. I don't fear poverty. I don't fear neglect. I don't feel abandonment. I don't feel any of those thoughts, even though I recklessly see things in my life. Just like Paul said, I see that in me that is in my flesh dwells no good thing, for the will is present. And how to perform that which is good, I find not. For the good I would, I do not, but that which I hate, I do. Then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in my flesh. Quit taking the ownership of the sin. Start taking the ownership of the righteousness. Say that sin nature was disannulled, that God's wrath was appeased against it because of the blood of Jesus. You don't have to obey the lusts that are in you anymore. You don't have to fall short. You just have to say, Lord God, when I'm weak, then you'll be my strength. If I start falling prey to weaknesses and vulnerable things in my life, God, I have to get up a voice of courage and say, God, remove that from me, please. I need it gone, God. You know what that is? Weakness. That's a son going to a father and saying, forgive me, I've sinned against you. And I'm so ashamed. How can I ever think you'd forgive me? And God says, because I said I would. Because I said I would. Because I said I would. Only I said I would. God wants you and me to be those ambassadors of his kingdom that are going to go out here in the highways and byways and bring people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. It's not what you're going to be and how clean you're going to be and how wonderful you are. It's how clean and beautiful and wonderful Jesus is. Listen, I want everybody in this whole town that's messed up to come to our church. Hey, you stink. Come on over to our church. Oh, man, you're a mess. Come on over to our church. We want you. You see, it's the sick that need a physician. You think getting all the clean people here? Look, all of a sudden you get them people here and you got a mess. Because they all of a sudden they're cleaner than you. Start, they won't tell you what kind of music to play. They won't tell you what to do and what to do here. And they're a bunch of control freaks. And next thing you know, boom, they say, well, this church wouldn't be anything without me here. Really? I bet heaven wouldn't be nothing without you here. I'm pretty God ain't nothing without you being here. Oh, no, I'd say that. No, that's what you're saying. God starts a work with a man. He starts it and he starts working it and building it. And people start putting a trust and confidence in what he's saying, not in what he's doing. If you start looking at what men do instead of what they say, you won't like them before it's over with. God didn't tell me to be perfect. He told me to be upright. To speak to those things that other people have need in their life to change. And one great thing is to get rid of fear. Get rid of it. Recognize it like a snake. Boy, I tell you what, my wife, she goes in there and she sees a mouse or something inside there. She goes, hey, there's a thing in there. It's like a tail. It's sticking up on the icebox. Go get it. You saw it. No. Well, sometimes we're going to have to say, you know, God, I'd be scared of that. Then he'll send James to go kill it. You see, but you got to deal with fear or it will control you. My granddaughter freaks out every time one of the little bugs flies around. And what do they call them? The little ones of sticky little claws. June bugs. June bugs. Oh, man, she's running. What are you doing? Kirsten, what are you doing? Watching a movie. Oh, look at it. I go, it's just a June bug. Pick it up and go outside and throw it away. It's no big deal. Man, Paul's brave. No, I'm just a little more educated. Now, if that was a yellow jacket, I wouldn't do that. See, but it's just wisdom. It's just knowing what we're all about. Amen? Well, praise God. Let's all stand. Faith was given to you and me by God. Faith is God's voice. God says, whatsoever you desire when you pray. Don't let people talk you out of faith. Don't let people come say, well, you're a name and a claim, or you're some other sort. And say, you know what? I think you need to go talk to God. I'm going to talk to God, and I'm going to call those things that be not those that were. I'm not going to sit here and say that when I get enough education or when I get strong enough or when I get all these things, I can be blessed. I'm throwing my life away. But when you can stand up today and say, I am blessed and highly favored of the Lord because he said so. Say, he said so. Then the problem in our life is we don't know what he said. When I go in and pray for people in the hospitals like that, listen, folks, those nurses tell me you got to put a mask on, you got to put gloves on, you got to put little curtains on you and all that other junk. I said, I've already covered. I'm covered with the blood. Fear not, for I am with you always. But fear says, not always. Not about this. Not about that. Well, I can write a book about all the places I've seen God come in and set people free in quarantine areas. And I didn't get what they got, but they got what I had. And they were healed and delivered and set free. Why? Because God is alive. And he says, I back my word. You could take it to the bank. I will not lie. I will not set you up for failure. I will set you up for victory. So you and I have got to get victorious so we can get out there and start bringing other people out of the dungeons, out of the pits, out of the fear, and bring them to the faith of the Son of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Raise your hands to God. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for that anointing that's here tonight. I call these men and women resurrected saints of the living God who fully understand the power of the resurrection. That Jesus, you rose from the dead and you established your covenant inside us. And we have no excuse. I don't care if we've had abuse. It's not reason for excuse. We got to rise up and be blessed because you said so alone. And Lord God, that faith of the Son of God will raise us up and put us before men that need it. You're not creating us to be show-offs. You said we're the ones to go out and reach the unreached and tell the untold. That, Lord God, this church is going to be full. I call it full in the name of Jesus. I say every person in the sound of my voice is going to rise up and invite them, pass out them big question tracts, get my little business cards, and put it in the hand to everybody and say, you need to come to our church. Here's the address. Here's our pastor's number. You need to come. Let me pray for you. And just bind that devil off them. And, Father God, we're going to see them coming on every way. We love you, Father, and we thank you for what you're doing in our lives. In Jesus' name, and we all said,
amen.
Praise God. I believe we got it. Hallelujah.